Fraser's a relatively new homie, and for the first time at SGDC, he's going to show you what he's working on.
Woo!
All right, so over the past little while, I've been really digging into immersive sims as a genre and trying to figure out what I can learn from that and take into my game. So start with, Here's a bunch of immersive sims. I won't really go into what they are quite yet, so I'll get into that a little bit later. But essentially what you're looking at is 30 years of cult classics, which always kind of bordered on mainstream success, but never quite got there. So if I really want to capture the immersive sim experience, why don't I just make one? Well, here's the budget for all these games. That's a lot of money. And the budget for my game, basically nothing. So, if I really want to get the experience of immersive sim down, I'm going to need to be a bit more smart about this and figure out what really makes these games tick. There's a bunch of unifying factors in immersive sims, things they all have in common, or seem to at least. These don't matter. What really matters is the fundamental goal of immersive sims, what I've been trying to figure out, what really works for the genre, which is agency, simple enough, only not quite, because it's agency within the context of action-based problem solving. So you're working in a real-time game. And moreover, it's a high amount of low-level agency. So what do I mean by that? Opus Magnum, something like that, has really incredibly low-level agency. Like, every decision you make is a massive choice, every move of the mouse, everything like that, it's all purposeful. Versus something like Mass Effect, all the agency is high-level, so all the choices you're making play out over the course of hours, and the actual gameplay itself is fairly formulaic. So, to be more specific even, we have an incredibly high amount of medium-low-level agency as a genre. How do they do that? Well, glad you asked. The first major thing is they have a world built out of predictable, consistent systems. So, like, if one wooden surface burns, then every wooden thing in the entire game is flammable, and you can light them. The high amount of internal consistency means the player is able to really experiment and probe the depths of the systems, and kind of use that to change their gameplay as a result. Beyond that, systems react with other systems to form emergent gameplay, and the player is kind of an agent of chaos. Right, so a couple months back, I was watching my dad play Breath of the Wild, which isn't an immersive sim for other reasons I'll get into, but it has that immersive gameplay. He saw a chandelier inside an enemy encampment over top of some explosive barrels, so he took aim, shot it down, and sure enough, it exploded and killed them. He then went on to spend the next, like, half an hour maneuvering barrels about and trying to lure and kite enemies over in order to get that in. Basically, the game turned into a whole different puzzle in a way that, I don't know, The Last of Us or Call of Duty never could, when you have, like, systems interacting with systems like that. Finally, the player builds a play style as they go. So out of the tools and knowledge they acquire and gain about systems, they can kind of craft the way they're playing. If you do it right, kind of like my dad, the pyromaniac, you'll be able to get your players to channel towards things that they like better. So, there's a couple weird things to avoid here, which wouldn't be obvious. Obvious locks and keys, like, you know, red magic opens red doors. Generally, they have next to no possibility for emergent gameplay, and I like to think if you can count how many solutions a problem has, you're probably doing it wrong. Like, key cards are fine, as long as you can pickpocket them key cards, you can sneak about to the guards, you can, you know, wear a disguise, you can climb in through a window, whatever else like that. Hitman is great for this, if you're looking for an example. Secondly, don't give the player all the tools. That's a bit counterintuitive, but if you just give the player everything they got, and they don't have time to really delve deep into one side of things, they can never quite get an understanding of the systems to the same level as if they have to actually be selective about that. All this culminates in what I would call the unifying philosophy of immersive sims. Levels are problems to solve using tools rather than content to churn through mechanically. Right, because I've not actually shown off stuff to the house yet, I'll read you just some copy from a thing I was writing earlier, basically trying to sum up the game. Put it concisely, the Chaos Insurgency is systems-driven mayhem you can sneak through. Half roguelike, half stealth game, half simulation, this thing is packed full of weird interactions of various systems, and it's up to you to problem-solve your way out of the problems your previous problem-solving has created. You play as a researcher working on a gun which allows its wielder to rewind time at dire consequence. Disillusioned with the secretive foundation you work for, you use your gun in conjunction with other anomalous objects you find along the way to weave through various foundation sites, leaving a merry trail of chaos and containment breaches wherever you go. It's also the closest thing the world's ever gotten to a bullet hell immersive sim mashup, and I think that's pretty rad. One problem. It's not an immersive sim yet. Okay, the core is there, the framework. You know, you have an entity system, you have gunplay, you have some vents, some sneaking about, but none of the systems play off of each other. I don't have anything that's really deep, emergent gameplay. Here's the plan. Until my game is an immersive sim, I'm gonna jam out a random system, basically just trying to get as quickly as possible some deep gameplay in there, something's acting in a cool way. Build some test scenarios, like Far Cry's Outposts, whatever. You know, something to really give the player a ways to play about and see what's fun. Playtest that, and basically look at those previous principles, see if it makes it more of an immersive sim. If it does, keep it. If not, toss it. Do this whole thing rapidly a whole bunch of times, and hopefully that'll make me an incredibly successful indie dev, and I'll retire to my millions. Thank you very much. Were there any questions? Oh, yeah.
Would you consider a game like Just Cause to be an immersive sim? Have you played Just Cause, or do you know what it looks like?
I haven't. I sort of know what it's like. I'd say it's just a little bit too linear, about right? With that mission setup and like set dedicated side things, it doesn't give you quite enough freedom to go maneuver about it. But it definitely has some of the elements.
I feel like then it goes into your definition of why Zelda can never be an immersive sim as well. I feel like Just Cause has the same issue because like the examples you had, like for example, Bioshock and Hitman are amazing in terms of agency, but in Just Cause, yeah, it also has the Zelda problem where it's kind of strange because you have all the tools and you don't have any like agency for choosing that.
Yeah.
The chat is asking, is Pokemon Go an immersive sim?
I'm going to leave that one up to your judgment.
Another one from the audience. Can you think of other examples of immersive sims meeting roguelikes? The only one I can think of on top of my head is Streets of Rogue.
That's a tough one. I'd say Spelunky, weirdly enough, gets close just because it has such deep emergent gameplay, which is, yeah, I don't know. It's kind of the direction I want to go, at least. Yeah.
So do you think that storytelling, especially environmental storytelling, is like an important part of immersive sims? And if yes, what do you plan on like doing that in a procedural generated game?
That's tough. I think if you played Dead Cells, it actually has a good system of like little vignettes almost of story, bits kind of sprung about throughout it. It's a lot about building up the world more than the actual thing. Dark Souls is another good one, where you just get hints of story kind of scattered about, and I think, at least using my procedural system, it should be able to accommodate for that.
What do you think about randomness versus intentional design? Like, because it feels like many of the big budget games, they're basically building so that you can do certain things in the games. But if you're going to have many levels, etc., somebody of your budget, you can't really spend the time handcrafting all that stuff unless you're going to have like a five-year production time or 10-year production time. So, what do you think about doing the random thing versus handcrafting all the situations where the player, like you put the barrel there because you know that that will probably be useful in that senior situation, for instance.
Yeah, you really hit the nail on the head right there. Handcrafted content will always be better. It will always have a leg up in that sense. But like you said, I'm one person. There's a limit to what I can do. And hopefully if I am careful about it and really go intentionally designing this thing from the ground up to facilitate good combats, even in not the best situations, and I should have a decent random generated game.
Do you think that they go very, very hard into the handcrafting stuff? Is that even immersive sim? Because you kind of like set up the situation. You know, you're kind of setting the player up to doing specific things. Is that then an immersive sim? Because they aren't the one who like comes up with the idea.
Well, I think there's a bit of a difference there because they came up with these situations, but they didn't come up with the solutions. The solutions are all on the player. And often you get these great stories of developers and designers having players come in and come up with ways to solve the problems that they weren't expecting whatsoever. That's really part of what makes this genre great. Absolutely.
Do you have any favorite game designers or game design like case studies that have inspired you for this certain project? Or generally?
Yeah, I'd say Tom Francis and a lot of his stuff is
yeah.
absolutely brilliant. Really, yeah. It's great. Watch his videos if you haven't. Yeah, I don't know. Too much to think of, like, not enough time.
Or any games in particular?
The original System Shock is really great, particularly, although I didn't go deep into it here, with the environmental storytelling and stuff like that. Also System Shock 2, obviously, but, like, yeah, it's underappreciated gem.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite games.
Yeah, it's pretty great. All right, thanks so much.